climate change is without a doubt among the greatest challenges that we face here in the US and in other countries around the world. And I'm just going to keep talking. And a host of economic and other government policies can be used to help curb its negative impacts. Subsidizing businesses that are devoted to clean energy, taxing firms that pollute, finding ways to incentivize better behavior and corporate responsibility are needed to help decarbonize the environment. And our next panel on sustainability and economic policy is going to delve into these issues. My colleague, I believe he's here, yes, he's here. Arun Majumdar is here to moderate this session, and he's really the perfect person to lead this discussion. He is the Chester Naramore Dean of the Stanford Doerr School of Sustainability, the J. Precourt Professor of Mechanical Engineering and Energy Science and Engineering, and a senior fellow and former director of the Precourt Institute for Energy. I could spend as with many of our panelists and moderators today, I could spend tons of time discussing his many accomplishments, but I'll just name a couple. Arun served in the Obama administration as the founding director of the Advanced Research Projects Agency, Energy, and as the acting undersecretary of energy. He served as a science envoy for the U.S. State Department and currently serves as the chair of the U.S. Secretary of Energy Advisory Board. Arun was also the vice president for energy at Google and is a member of the U.S. National Academy of Sciences, the U.S. National Academy of Engineering, and the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. It's such a pleasure and honor to have him with us here today. So with that, let me hand things over to my colleague, Arun Majumdar.
Thanks for that. This is going to be a terrific panel. We have Bob Litterman and Catherine Wolfram. And we have been called the ABCs of sustainable energy and economic policy. So anything you want to learn, this is it. But it's a tremendous pleasure to be here. We have in our panel Bob Litterman, who is the founding partner of Kepos Capital. And for 23 years, Bob was in Goldman Sachs. And what I find amazing is that he was the co-developer with Fisher Black, right? Mm-hmm. The Black-Litterman Global Asset Allocation Model, which is a key tool in investment management. And I won't go into the details. There are several, all the details are here. But I also want to introduce my former colleague, Catherine Wolfram. And you know, my former meaning that I used to be at Berkeley. They still haven't thrown me out here. And Catherine, we were colleagues at Berkeley. Catherine was in the High School of Business and still there, but visiting Harvard University. But more recently, she was the assistant secretary of Treasury, assistant secretary for climate and energy economics. Did I get that right?
Deputy
assistant secretary for climate and energy economics in U.S. Treasury. And as we will go into this, this has been a time of major policy related to energy and climate. And so just to set the stage historically of where we are, we are in a situation which is, I think, quite unique and unprecedented. In Paris, the Paris Agreement in 2015 was an acknowledgement of a problem. In the COP26 in Glasgow, we had major countries make commitments, net zero commitments. United States 2050, China 2060, India 2070, Germany 2045. Everyone's made, all the major nations have made climate commitments to get to a net zero economy. As of now, we have more than 60% of the Fortune 500 companies that have made a climate commitment. And if you really ask the question, do they know how to get there? The answer is no. No one really knows how to get there. There are policies being introduced now to create pathways to get there, but a lot of those policies are yet to be developed. And I think that's the situation we are in, a massive global transition. The International Energy Agency has said that for this global energy transition to happen, that needs an investment on the order of $4 trillion per year for the next 30 years. So that's on the order of 100 trillion, 100 to 120, plus minus a few trillion here and there. That is what is required. And the question is, how is that going to happen? So this is, we are going to get into this discussion, but it is very unique that despite all the challenges in the world, internationally and all, there's something that we all aligned on. Not everyone, but a majority. And that's the good news story. The question is, how do we navigate this path? And that's what we're going to get into. So we're going to start with some short presentations. We're going to start with Bob first, and then we'll get into the Q&A. Bob?
All right. Thank you, Arun. It's a pleasure to be here. I want to talk about carbon markets, and in particular, something that we put together at Kepos Capital called the Carbon Barometer. And this way I can do it this way. I testified 2 weeks ago before a Senate Budget Committee hearing that was held by Senator Whitehouse on climate risk and potential financial damages. And in that, we had three witnesses. Mark Carney was one, I was one, and an economist, Douglas Holtz-Eaton, was a third. He was a Republican witness. All three of the witnesses agreed the solution to this problem is to put a price on carbon. We need incentives to reduce emissions. As you mentioned, Arun, we all know where we're going. The only question is, how are we going to get there? How do we get $4 trillion of investment? And the answer is, you have to have incentives. So at Kepos Capital, and working with another company, Grow Intelligence, we decided a few years ago to start looking at where are these incentives globally. And so we put together this carbon barometer, which is a measure of, it's a comprehensive measure of incentives to reduce emissions around the globe and over time. We have 25 countries. We have seven different policies that I'll talk about that we include. We can measure this incentive at the global level, at the country level, and then by policy within countries. We now have 14 years of data starting in 2008 through 2021, and we cover 83% of the emissions. Now, the policies are listed here. The first two are a carbon tax or an emissions trading system. These are the most obvious policies to put a price on carbon. It turns out they're the least important globally. The next two, fossil fuel taxes and fossil fuel subsidies, are policies that were not designed to reduce emissions. Fossil fuel taxes obviously are an incentive to reduce emissions, particularly if you have an alternative, an electric vehicle. Fossil fuel subsidies, which are ubiquitous, especially in the developing world, are a very significant disincentive to reducing emissions. And then you have a number of policies that have been used, feed-in tariffs, paying people to produce electricity and put it into the grid, renewable portfolio standards, which set a standard for carbon and electricity generation, and then finally low-carbon fuel standards, which is another way to try and reduce emissions in transportation. Now, this page shows the main story here, which is number one, there are not strong incentives to reduce emissions. The average price per ton globally, $18.45. Now, for a long time, the U.S. Government policy was that the social cost of carbon was something like $50 a ton. But more recently, those estimates have gotten much higher, so that recently the think tank Resources for the Future estimated that the social cost of carbon is about $180 a ton. And so the global average is an order of magnitude too low. Now, if you see that graph on the left-hand side of the screen, the green bars are the prices in different countries. And so not only is the global average much too low, but you see there's a total absence of global harmonization. The countries at the top, I don't know if you can all read the small print, but Spain, the United Kingdom, France, Netherlands, Germany, all Europe, right? Europe has strong incentives to reduce emissions. Europe has been leading the way. Those incentives in Spain, 130, and in the UK, about $130 a ton. And then the red bars, which you can hardly see them in Europe because they're so small, are the amount of emissions by country. So you see the countries that really matter are China, which has by far the largest emissions, the United States, India, and where those are located in this graph is all near the center, which is to say we do not have strong incentives to reduce emissions. We basically haven't started in either United States, China, or India. And then you can see there are a number of countries, particularly in the Middle East and Latin America, where you have strong negative incentives. These are basically countries that have fossil fuel subsidies and nothing on the other side. And so, and typically it's a fixed price for gasoline. So as the global price for oil goes up and down, those subsidies go up and down. But when they're below the global price on oil, you get significant subsidies. And then finally, I'll just show that these prices, especially for the global average, are driven by the big emitters, the US and China. And we have been slowly raising our prices over time, but much too slowly, and they're still much too low. And so right now, the United States has a price that's about $17.95, i.e. below the global average. It's not nearly enough. And then China, $12.40, similarly much too low. Interestingly, though, some people, economists will tell you that the amount of damage done by a ton of carbon is the same everywhere in the world, and so the incentive to reduce it should be the same. Some people like to look, though, at how much can you afford to spend to reduce your emissions. And what you can see, the United States are spending, that is the incentives that we create relative to our GDP, is 0.38%, much too low. China, although they have a lower price, has more than double the incentive. Those incentives in Europe are double again what you see in China. They're about 1.5%, in some countries a little higher and some a little lower. And then you find that carbon charge per unit of GDP actually is higher in developing countries like India. Maybe not a surprise because the GDP is so much lower. I'll stop there and turn it over to Catherine.
Thank you. This was a great teaser for an international look. Now Catherine's going to give us a domestic look.
Great. Thanks so much, Arun. And thanks so much to Mark. This has been a really fun day, and the whole CEPR team. This has been a really entertaining, really fun. And thank you to you. It's the last panel, so thanks for sticking around. As Arun said, I served as the Deputy Assistant Secretary for Climate and Energy at U.S. Treasury. And you might be thinking, Treasury, climate, energy, what's the link there? When I first started talking to Treasury, it was the end of 2020, and the Georgia runoff hadn't happened yet, nor was anybody talking about a land war in Europe. But after that, the Democrats won both Senate elections in the Georgia runoff, and that enabled the Senate Democrats to pass the Inflation Reduction Act, just sweeping climate legislation through the budget reconciliation process. And Russia, the world's largest oil exporter, invaded its neighbor. And so because the Inflation Reduction Act went through budget reconciliation, it meant that a lot of the incentives went through the tax code, which meant that Treasury was heavily involved in those discussions. Also, Treasury historically has really overseen the sanctions process. It runs the financial sanctioning. And so the last 10 months that I was there, I was heavily involved with the sanctions on Russian energy, the price cap on Russian oil in particular. I'm not going to talk about that. I'm happy to talk about that in the Q&A. But Treasury ended up being really kind of the central place to be doing energy in ways that I couldn't have foreseen. OK, so what I want to talk about is the Inflation Reduction Act and give some quick facts. I'm sure you've all heard the broad headlines. It's really a transformative climate piece of climate legislation. it really puts the U.S. back on the world stage, lets us go to our partners with our head held high. We are well on our way to achieving our Paris climate target of 50% reductions from 2005 levels. What I want to talk about is some of the specifics. I just have two slides and then happy to talk about this further in the Q&A. But I wanted to start, a good third of the estimated fiscal cost of the Inflation Reduction Act will be tax credits for renewable investments in renewable electricity generation. And so this is an example of one of those big tax credits. It's the investment tax credit. And what we're doing is plotting on the right-hand side the tax credit that's available under the Inflation Reduction Act. On the left-hand side is the historical investment tax credit that was available to solar generators. So historically, only solar generators could take up basically only solar generators could take up the inflation or the investment tax credit. So a couple things to note about the Inflation Reduction Act. One is they're very generous subsidies. So it's a 50% tax credit. 50% of the cost of the investment can be recouped with the tax credit. Historically, it was lower. It was 30%. And historically, it was also volatile. It was, you know, sometimes going down, sometimes disappearing. And so the renewable generators, the companies that I've talked to have suggested that the fact that the Inflation Reduction Act means that over the next 10 years, for sure, they will get the 50% investment tax credit really gives them a lot of certainty, a lot of kind of bankability, and a lot of incentive to invest. The other thing that I wanted to highlight with the Inflation Reduction Act is kind of the components of the 50% tax credit. So those are the colors on the bar. And the big component, the big green space on that bar is what's available to companies if they pay prevailing wages and if they use apprenticeship programs. It's a huge incentive to do those things. You basically get five times what you would have gotten. You get like 6% if you don't do those things. You get like 30% if you do those things. So it's really, Secretary Rice this morning talked about, you know, bringing along the communities that are losing out because of the transition away from fossil fuels. And so, you know, something like this makes sure that we're using union labor. The yellow bar at the top of the chart there is a bonus that's added if the investment is made in what's called an energy community. So if you're going to those fossil fuel communities and building the clean power there, then you get an additional incentive. So really, really designed to kind of address some of those issues that Secretary Rice raised this morning. So here's a very similar graph for the production tax credit. I wanted to highlight one thing, which is that the bonus proportions are different. So here the incentives for the energy community or for the domestic content are a little bit smaller. And also, again, you see that historically there was lots of volatility in the production tax credit that was available for wind generators. So, you know, at a broad scale, maybe you've heard the number $369 billion as the amount that the U.S. is going to invest in the climate transition. I get a little frustrated with the media because that number sounds really precise, and it seems like the U.S. is like writing a check for $369 billion. But what they're doing is putting these tax credits out there, and now it's up to the private sector. It's up to companies to invest and take up those tax credits. We'll see. You know, it might end up being $369 billion. It might end up being lower if there are a lot of problems getting permitting, problems getting access to transmission. But it could end up being a lot higher if it's really transformative. And to address the climate crisis, it really does need to be transformative. So I think we should be cheering for more than $369 billion. Thanks.
Fantastic. So we'll get into some of these details a little bit more deeper. But you know, we'll just have a conversation. I think that'll be fun to do. And I know that we stand between this and the drinks. So we'll try to entertain, but hang in there. So, you know, you mentioned the Inflation Reduction Act. Actually, it is a historic time because it's the Inflation Reduction Act. It is also the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act and the CHIPS and Science Act. Now, if you take all that, the combination, I'm assuming where the thought was that this 1 plus 1 plus 1 could be greater than 3. So you put all that together, and maybe, Catherine, if you give us an idea of where, you know, how, what does that mean to the U.S. energy infrastructure, as well as the international side? Because this has, what U.S. does has international implications.
Yeah, sure. So let me just give one example. In the inflation, in the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act, one thing that it does is spend $7.5 billion building out a nationwide charging system for electric vehicles. And economists talk about this kind of chicken and egg problem, right? You know, you don't want to invest in an electric vehicle if you don't see a lot of charging stations out there because you're worried that you won't be able to charge your car. And so the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act is really trying to push out lots of chargers and give people the incentive to buy an electric vehicle. Now, the Inflation Reduction Act adds on top of that the tax credit for an electric vehicle and really tries to kind of supercharge the, I didn't mean that as a pun, but I guess it is one, the adoption of electric vehicles and really tries to kind of push the electric vehicle industry down the learning curve. And so you asked about the international implications. To the extent we're successful making cheap electric vehicles, making cheap green hydrogen, really kind of developing some of these nascent industries, and you know, you thought about nascent industries at RPE, but things like direct air capture, carbon capture and sequestration, there's some really strong incentives in the Inflation Reduction Act to invest in carbon capture and sequestration, and that could really be transformative if we're able to, as I said, push down the costs and then export those technologies to the rest of the world.
So let me actually follow up on that. I mean, if you go back in history, especially when I was in the Department of Energy, at that time we had major incentives from Germany for solar, the feed-in tariffs, which was just so sweet that people, you know, jumped in, even though, you know, Germany has the amount of solar insulation like Alaska, but nevertheless, they went in deep into solar, and that was an incentive. And then that, combined with Chinese manufacturing, just reduced the cost of solar for everyone around the world. So, Bob, do you think this, the Inflation Reduction Act, the incentives for hydrogen and the other thing, do you think that could do the same for the world?
Yeah,
should the U.S. taxpayer be paying for that?
Oh, well, that's another question. It certainly is a positive, you know, and a big increase in the amount of funding for this kind of research and development. But, you know, whether it actually is enough is, of course, the question. And you mentioned we need $3 or $4 trillion a year of spending. And Inflation Reduction Act is, well, who knows how big it is, but it's advertised at 369 billion, so 36 billion a year. You know, that's two orders of magnitude too small. So where's the other 99% going to come from? And the answer has to be from market forces. It has to be that entrepreneurs think that their investments are going to be, you know, profitable down the road, and that's why they're making those investments. So we really have to scale up the flow of capital, and that's going to come from having the right incentives, not from taxpayers paying for, you know, research and development.
So let's go into the incentives, and, you know, if I look at the Inflation Reduction Act, it is a set of carrots, right? It is, there are no sticks in there. But if you go back in how, for example, solar and wind deployment happened in the United States, there was investment tax credits for solar, production tax credit for wind, and that was to reduce the green premium. But then there was RPS, the Renewable Portfolio Standard, in California and various states. So it was a combination of carrots and sticks, which was bankable. And then the private sector came in. But given that the Inflation Reduction Act is only a bunch of carrots, I mean, I don't want to minimize it, it's a huge carrot, what about the sticks? What's missing?
So just one small correction. There is one stick, or you know, at least one stick in the Inflation Reduction Act. There's a methane fee. Yeah, the MERP, the Methane Emission Reduction Program, not the best acronym. That is in the Inflation Reduction Act. The Republicans are trying to get rid of it, but
that's the only price on carbon we have in the United States, yeah, is the price on methane.
The federal. At the federal level.
That's,
yeah,
right.
Yeah. But I think in the optimistic view of the world, the carrots and the sticks work together. That the U.S. federal government has put out all these carrots, but then that makes it more attractive for states to enact renewable portfolio standards, to have the sticks. So, you know, you could see this virtuous cycle of carrots and sticks working together.
So if you now take the international viewpoint, Bob, you showed the international sort of the carbon price and the carbon barometer. Is it possible to use the United States carrots and the taxpayer paying for it and a stick in Europe or somewhere else to really move the ball faster?
Oh, absolutely. The incentives will work whether they're carrots or sticks. It's really just a question of the magnitude. And the issue is, you know, you take $40 billion a year and average that across emissions in the U.S., you know, it's less than $10. You know, so yeah, we'll go from where are we, $18 to $28, and I hope it's three or four times as big as that, and maybe you get to $30 or $40 a ton. We should be at $200 a ton. Right. That's where we need to be. So we're just not anywhere close to where we need to be. And in Europe, they're at 130. They're not far off. You know, they're leading the way, and we should just, you know, pass some incentives to, you know, more incentives are better. So I don't care if they're carrots or sticks. One of the problems with carrots, and actually the Inflation Reduction Act was very good about this, is that it was not specific, technology specific. It was any low carbon approach, you know, gets a production tax credit. So that's a good thing, rather than saying, all right, we're gonna subsidize solar or we're gonna subsidize wind.
Subsidize the hydrogen. Yeah. At $3 a kilogram, which makes electrolysis hydrogen actually viable. Otherwise, there's no chance.
Right. So all of these different technologies, it's relatively technology neutral. So that's good. But, you know, taxpayers have to pay for it. Right. Much better to say polluters pay and then just, you know, get on with the game.
So, Bob, you and I have been on, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Oh, so I just wanted to jump in on the US-EU. Yeah. You asked whether that could be a good thing. Right now, the Europeans think it's a bad thing. I mean, they're very upset, up in arms about the subsidies. And, you know, the subsidies are quite large. And so there are companies that are announcing that they're moving from Europe to the US. But I don't want to suggest that they're only moving because of the subsidies. You know, the EU is right now facing very high gas prices. There are other things that might be driving companies out of the EU. But I do think the extent to which, you know, what countries do and the policies they adopt, how that influences trade is going to be really important going forward. And, you know, you can see that the bad scenario developing where this leads to trade wars, where, you know, if we get into subsidy wars and we're just competing for the same resources and spending more and more government revenue, that's not a good thing. There are good subsidy wars where we're, you know, competing with each other to make cheaper and cheaper clean hydrogen or cheaper and cheaper direct air capture. But I think policymakers will really have to pay attention to these, the extent to which climate policy interacts with trade and how what we do influences what other countries do.
Yeah. So, yeah, go ahead.
Absolutely. I was going to say that the trade component of this is really important, because what you really need if you put a carbon tax on is to protect your domestic industry. Mm-hmm. So you need to have some sort of border adjustment mechanism. Europe has has legislated one already. The U.S. is now negotiating. And one way forward is to use trade policy to create incentives globally for everyone to become part of a carbon club, they call it, mm-hmm. where we all have a price on carbon and we also have these border adjustments.
Well, talk about trade. I mean, one of the things that was brought up in Davos, I was there in a sort of small kind of energy discussion about the Inflation Reduction Act, was about the protectionist features of it. So any thoughts on that?
Well, the U.S. is very relatively clean in terms of a lot of industries, cement, steel, and so on. And so since we're already cleaner than most manufacturers, this would help us. This would make our manufacturers more competitive. So it is a policy that you know, a number of Republicans have gotten behind. And just as they snuck a methane tax into the Inflation Reduction Act, you never know, you might be able to put a carbon tariff into,
well.
into a border carbon
slip
adjustment
it in.
Mechanism.
Some appropriation mechanism.
Yeah, you betcha.
It's an annual thing. That's great. That'll be great. Wonderful.
So I learned the term in D.C., hope casting instead of forecasting. So this might be a hope cast. But, you know, as inflation rates go, or as interest rates go up, when the Trump tax cuts expire, there will be fiscal constraints that we're facing that might make raising fiscal revenue rather than spending fiscal revenue more important in the future.
Let's talk a little bit about carbon markets. And Bob, you and I have been on an email trail with a few other people on carbon markets. And right now, here it is, voluntary carbon markets. And we would expect the carbon markets to have transactions and trade based on natural climate solutions and all. And you know, this could be extremely large. Why isn't it scaling up? What are the gaps in the carbon markets?
Yeah, no, it's a great question.
Do we need another conference for that?
We probably need a whole day on that. But the short answer is that these markets do lack integrity. They're very small right now. But they should scale and they should be developed because there are ways to sequester carbon in natural landscapes, in the oceans as well, that are relatively cheap, you know, $10, $20 a ton. Now, there's issues about additionality, permanence, leakage, double counting, all these issues, they can be addressed. One of the biggest issues is just measuring the flux of carbon out of the atmosphere into these landscapes. But we have much better technology now, remote sensing technology, that can really measure that. So then it's a question of addressing some of these other issues which are more political. Jurisdictional governance. We need governments to put in place policies to create standards so that we can, you know, have confidence that when there is an offset, it actually represents a ton of carbon going into the ground or not. And then the other thing I would say, especially here at Stanford, where we have the Natural Capital Project and the New School of Sustainability, it's not all about carbon. It's also about all these other ecosystem services, whether it's biodiversity or clean water or pollination or indigenous peoples who live on these lands. So there's this, people often talk about the quality of the carbon. It has to do with those issues as well as permanence. So a lot of complexity to this, but again, come back to the fact that this is a market that, on the one hand, at best, it can probably produce a third of the solution. These, you know, the amount of carbon that we need to pull out of the atmosphere is just so large that there's not that much capacity in natural climate solutions, but they are the cheapest, and so that's where we should start. And the other thing I would say is that if you create a global market for natural climate solutions, it is kind of by definition a harmonized market, and that's what we need, globally harmonized incentives to reduce emissions. So let's get started, start with these natural climate solutions, and then as we run out of those opportunities, we will scale into the engineered solutions.
But isn't what is missing a trusted carbon standard of some kind?
It is.
Which is based on science, where the carbon goes, with uncertainties and timestamps and all of that. And that will require some science.
It does.
To be able to get there.
Yes.
And let's say we somehow figure this out. So do you have hope in developing such a standard in the next 5 years or so?
5 years is tough.
Because this is, we have got,
I know, it's urgent. It's urgent. We should get to work on this.
The additionality is really tough. It's not just a measurement, like scientific measurement issue. It's figuring out what would have been done otherwise. So
well, yeah. I mean, the issue is that we don't know. That counterfactual never.
Yeah.
So what you need is you need governments to just agree on baselines. And then once they're agreed on, everyone has the incentive to create as much carbon as they can. It's sort of a one-time transfer from presumably developed countries to developing countries as we set these baselines. And then once they're set, the country has an incentive to create as much carbon sequestration as possible.
That brings up another point. If you think about this global energy transition, most of the growth, population growth, energy infrastructure growth and all, is in the global south. Mm-hmm. Whereas, so that's where the capital is actually needed.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Whereas the capital source is most likely going to be in the global north. So will this massive capital transfer from north to the south, how will that actually happen? Do we have the global institutions, can we adapt the current global institutions to make that happen smoothly? Or do we need new institutions? Because most of the institutions that we have today came out of World War II, and when war ended, we created institutions to have these transactions to happen. Any thoughts?
Well, I don't know that we need new institutions. We need markets. And in order to get the markets, you need standards. You know, this carbon flux should be a commodity just like any other commodity. And we need standards. We know how to do this. These things are, they can be done. Now, in terms of natural climate solutions, we also need permanence. And, you know, if you plant trees in California, they're not going to last for 500 years. You know, they have a probability of lasting and risk. And where you really want these natural climate solutions is in the tropics, where they're going to be more permanent. So that does fit in with this idea of if you create these markets, you'll get flows of capital from the north to the south. That's where those solutions are. Now, more generally, in terms of where we have to develop energy, it's the developing south. And there again, if we have the markets and the technology is there, there will be entrepreneurs who will invest in those economies to build the capital to create the energy, the clean energy. So it's all about markets. Ultimately, we need these incentives, and that comes from governments. So it's very frustrating, but you know, we got to get there.
Yeah, I guess I would just layer on top of that. So my former boss, Secretary Yellen, is working with the World Bank. I don't think we need new institutions. I think the existing institutions might need a little bit of redirection, but that seems to be happening already. You also mentioned capital transfer, but I think in addition we need technology transfer. And so there, it comes back to trade. I mean, that trade really helps transfer technology. So if the U.S. and the EU and, you know, the global north are successful and really making clean energy cheap, we need to get that to the global south. And there, you know, again, I don't think we necessarily need new institutions, but we need to be paying attention to trade and how that can help with that technology transfer.
We will open it up for questions in a few minutes, but just one note on this international trade issue. You mentioned Russia and Ukraine. That's anything to do with energy is a national security issue as well. It's not just a climate and economics. There are other security concerns that are supply chain related, because as we transition, let's say we go into electrification or transportation, we need batteries for that, and we need critical minerals for that. And when you overlay on top of trade security assurances, that landscape changes. And so given and we have to bring in China at some point and India at some point in this discussion, when you look ahead, what do you see in terms of trade given these constraints, boundary conditions, and what do you think we should be doing moving into this?
Yeah, so I like Secretary Rice's quote from this morning that globalization is a fact, not a policy. So yeah, we are trading, that's there. But I do think there's nothing like going without something to make you realize how much you or your economy relies on it. So for instance, in California, we've had the public safety power shutoffs. People have lost power for days, and we see how the traffic lights don't work, the gas pumps don't work, you know, just the economy grinds to a halt. We saw in the Russia-Ukraine conflict how Putin like deliberately targeted the energy infrastructure to terrorize the Ukrainian people by blowing out electric substations. You can leave people without water, without heat. So I think, you know, especially as we move to a more electrified economy, I think these issues of electric reliability will become very, very important. And, you know, it also relates to the supply chain, where we get the critical minerals for the batteries or the you know, the wind turbines. We're thinking hard about those issues.
Well, I think the geopolitical issues revolve a lot around how quickly we make this transition. I think everyone knows we're going to make a transition to net zero, but is it going to be quick or is it going to be slow? And different countries, which have different endowments of fossil fuels, are in very different positions. So Russia is really in no hurry to have the world transition off of fossil fuels. Saudi Arabia has, I think, 80-year supply of fossil fuels at the current production. And so for Saudi Arabia, for the world to move off of fossil fuels is a problem. Now, India and China, they're relatively scarce fossil fuel reserves. So it's in their interest to move quickly. But it's not that simple because, for instance, in China today, they are now planning to build more coal-fired power plants in the short run because they need that capacity in the short run. And you know, maybe eventually they'll get off of it. But and so on the one hand, they're building electric cars and buses and solar and wind. And on the other, they're building coal-fired power plants because they, in the short run, need so much electricity. So I think it's complicated. You look at Europe in this context. Europe is does not have a lot of fossil fuel reserves. And so when Russia invaded, their reaction was, we just got to, you know, increase the speed of the transition. And so I think in that context, the U.S. is kind of in the middle. We are rich in fossil fuel reserves. And so we don't have the same incentive to move quickly to get off. And you see it in those prices, in those incentives that I showed.
Okay, let's open it up to the audience. Anyone with questions? Yes.
Are there any incentives to capture carbon during the end of a product life cycle? For example, when we consume more, they end up in landfills, and they just generate methane in these landfills, and in the global south, they often burn the landfills to get rid of waste. Are there any policies in place trying to fix this issue during the entire product life cycle?
Life cycle carbon pricing, or for that matter, incentives?
Yeah, that's a really, really good question. The, you know, the economic ideal is, as Bob said, to price the carbon going in, and then that would give people an incentive not to develop things that are using carbon, and so you don't need to think about it as hard at the end of the life cycle. So, you know, to the extent that we're subsidizing clean energy, getting away from fossil fuels and the energy production, those things are happening, but not so much attention paid to the end of the life cycle.
There was a question over there. Okay, maybe there are quite a few hands up. Maybe we go in that region and get two questions out, and then we'll come by and then we move the mic.
Great, thanks for the time today. We've been speaking for, you all have been speaking for about 30 minutes. And there has been one mention of nuclear energy. and curious as to why that is, and then what some of your thoughts are around it.
Nuclear energy, let's go to the second question over there. That's a very good point.
Mine's more general. My observation from travel in the developing world is that there's a great deal of resentment that the developed world relied on carbon to develop, and we're sort of asking them to leapfrog development into a new frontier, which is an entirely set or certain. Does that make any sense, that question?
So there was I'm going to, you know, sort of reframe. Fairness issue. West did this with carbon. We are asking the developing world to do it off carbon. Mm-hmm. Is it fair or not? So nuclear.
So we talked about the Inflation Reduction Act. The Inflation Reduction Act also includes incentives for nuclear power. So it includes incentives to keep existing nuclear plants, basically a production tax credit for existing nuclear. So, you know, definitely seen as an important part of the clean energy mix.
Does the IRA have incentives in place, for example, investment tax credit, to reduce the premium for a small modular reactor?
As Bob indicated, it's technology neutral.
Production tax credits.
Yeah, starting in 2025. Whatever you do, as long as it's zero carbon, if it's small modular nuclear, wind, yeah.
Bob, you have any thoughts?
No, I agree exactly with Catherine. Nuclear, I'm a big supporter of nuclear. Of course, it's really the small modular new generation that's going to be useful going forward. And then on the fairness issue, it's not fair. I mean, you know, what can I say? But we're all in this together. That's the important thing that we have to recognize. We have to solve this problem going forward.
Right. I mean, the geopolitical implications of that get raised all the time. And, you know, when you talk to the business community, and a few of us, Tom Stevenson and I and Condi and a few others were in India a few weeks back. And, you know, many of the businesses are looking at this as a business opportunity. And that's a very different framing, whereas, you know, others may look at it as a burden. So I think it really depends on the framing of how you look at it. But yeah, both are present at this point. Let's move over there. I can see two hands.
Hi, thank you. So I'm a student, I'm a freshman, and I'm from Missouri, and Missouri's climate opinions vary. But one of the things that, like, especially as a young person, and especially as 2020 and there are the social justice movements, the concept of climate change being the existential threat. But as you guys have mentioned, there is a fiscal cost and to all of these actions. And I think one of the questions that I've wondered for a while is to implement the level of change that we need, like you said, $4 trillion every year for the next 30 years, if we want to do this in a way that is at least semi-responsible, what must we sacrifice? But also, what do you think we should sacrifice? If that makes sense.
Great question. Let's add another question to that. And this is about, okay, so is it a zero-sum game, or is there a way to do it in a different way?
My name is Ken Judd. My question is, what would the impact on the growth rate of poor countries be if we actually went to $150 a ton?
So if the carbon price is 150, what would it be? So let's address the first question on, you know,
sure.
So what do you sacrifice?
Yeah, the standard, you know, economic answer is if you substitute a more expensive production for a less expensive, it's going to cost you more. But, you know, another approach to this is to say, look, we've been living for several decades now, but especially the last 10 years, in a lot of uncertainty about where policy is going. And so investors haven't known, should I be investing in this or that? So it's very possible that by setting policy you know, in the direction that we all know we're eventually going to go, that will actually create additional investment in the short run and stimulate the economy. It's not clear at all that there's going to be a cost of actually doing this. And then certainly if you think about the welfare implications, you know, there's a tremendous loss of welfare from not pricing carbon today. And it's the loss of welfare of future generations. They're not here to oppose it, but this is totally unfair. It is absolutely criminal that this generation is not pricing carbon. And it's going to impact future generations. Our grandchildren are going to live in a society that is, you know, who knows? But there's a tremendous risk that it'll be much worse off because of what we're doing today.
Catherine.
I guess I wouldn't get too stuck on the $4 trillion. That embeds some assumptions about what technology will cost 20, 30, 40 years ago. We're not very good at making those forecasts. Yeah, wind and solar prices over the last 10 years have come down dramatically, and people were not forecasting that 10 years ago. So, you know, I think there's a bit of, maybe it's easy for me to say as an economist, I can have techno-optimism because I'm not developing the technologies, but yeah, if we're successful pushing things down the learning curve and making them cheaper, if your generation is successful making those innovations, then it becomes easier. I don't want to lean on this too heavily, but I guess I would also point out there are co-benefits people talk about with adopting renewable energy. You know, right now coal just emits terrible particulate matter, and people are dying. They're arguably the biggest killer right now, or the biggest contributor to mortality in the world, is air pollution. And so, you know, there are other things. It's not all sacrifices.
You're saying the cost of inaction can be more than the cost of action. Is that what you suggest?
Well, that's clearly the case. I mean, people have done those calculations just looking at the cost of climate change, but I'm saying that there are other benefits.
Go ahead.
Oh, sorry. To Ken Judd's question. So I don't think that the right answer, or that the answer has to be everyone impose a $150 a ton carbon tax. There's a proposal. I mean, this gets to the fairness issue. There's a proposal out of the IMF, for instance, to have a graduated carbon tax, to have, you know, $25 for the low-income countries, $50 for middle and higher for the higher income.
So, you know, our own beloved former Secretary of State, George Shultz, who was really one of the founders of CEPR, and he, you know, he had proposed with Secretary Baker the revenue neutral carbon tax, which starts off at a small amount, let's say $10 or $15, and then ramps up over time to $50, $60 or more. And I mean, that from a purely economics point of view, I'm not an economist, but even it makes sense to me. What are the chances of actually trying to get this? And we were hoping that the revenue neutral would be politically feasible.
Maybe I can respond
to
that. Because, you know, I co-chair the Climate Leadership Council with Catherine Murdoch, and that's our plan. We've been sponsoring that. Of course, it came from Stanford originally with George and with Jim Baker. But, you know, I think it's one of these things that no one thinks it's ever going to happen until it happens, and it will just happen. Everyone knows, as I said in this hearing 2 weeks ago, even the Republican witness knew we need to have a carbon tax. Everyone knows that's where we're going. The problem is it's a global coordination, and you know, how do you get the U.S. to move without China moving? And so the politics are tough, but I certainly haven't given up. Everyone kind of in the privacy of their own office, even the Republicans will tell you, yeah, I know, Bob, that's the right thing to do, but if I say it out loud, I'm going to lose my position, and you know, what good is that going to do?
You think, I mean, that's another way of saying leadership really matters at this point?
Leadership matters tremendously, yeah.
I would also emphasize, people say it's politically impossible, but you really have to add in the U.S. So Canada basically has that. They have an escalating carbon price. They're redistributing the revenues from that back to people.
Right. So, Europe has it. Yeah. I mean, it can be done.
So there was a hand on, so let's see, there's a with hand with over there. Yeah, go ahead.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the panel. Great discussion. California, the state of California, has made significant commitments to reducing carbon emissions in it throughout the economy. At the same time, and which will require substantial fiscal investment by the state in the coming years, but at the same time, right now, the state is facing a budget deficit. And so I was curious just to hear your thoughts about the value of the state of California making this continued investment. If we continue to go down that road right now, it means we have to make reductions to other policy priorities within the state, and so there's a trade-off involved. So from a global perspective, what is the value of California's contribution to this effort?
Let's go to another question over there, and so that we can capture two. So California and its context in the world.
Hi there. I kind of wanted to circle back to the trade effects of the IRA you two mentioned. I really wanted to know more about these, I guess your hope cast as the Treasury prepares to issue some guidance on these IRA tax credits in the face of like European problems the Europeans and others have with the IRA.
There's another question, or let's take those two, California, and then the trade issue.
I'll take the Treasury one, and I do not speak for Treasury. I'm no longer there. You might have followed. They issued some guidance on the electric vehicle tax credits and the way that. So I guess like first of all, the law is the law. The legislation is passed that we have to implement the law. There are some guidance documents coming out where there are issues of interpretation. And so for instance, the electric vehicle tax credit, there are strong domestic content, domestic assembly provisions for like passenger vehicles, but there were not the same for commercial vehicles, and Treasury interpreted commercial vehicles to include leased vehicles. And so you know, that's kind of a game changer from the perspective of the EU vehicle manufacturers, because as long as people are buying or people are getting their vehicles leased, then the domestic content provisions don't apply. So, you know, kind of keep your eyes. There are details to this that can really matter.
California.
Well, I'm not an expert on California climate policy, but I would say that California obviously has been in a leadership position within the U.S. It's got a carbon tax. It's, $27 a ton or something now. And it's much better if it's nationally coordinated, and it's even better if it's globally coordinated. So it's really hard to address this locally, and that's one of the things that makes it difficult, but I would say California has been a leader, and we should congratulate it for that.
So let's come over here, and then we'll go. There's another hand over there.
Yeah. I'm going to counter the California leader. I've had solar on my house for 7 years, and the state doesn't want to pay me for it anymore. So, I mean, I'm just going to, like, start mining Bitcoin if I'm not going to get the electricity back. So I like your comments about the reduction of the incentives for rooftop solar in California.
Wait, so there's another question, I think, over there.
So I've heard that if all Americans owned electric cars, the grid could not support charging them because most of them are charged at night. And it would be a big leap to ramp up the grid to enable that. So I'd be interested in your impressions.
Actually, let's add a third question, the lady over here. Here, right in front.
Thank you. Earlier you mentioned the comparatively low carbon charges as a percentage of GDP for the United States, but then you also spoke about how the Inflation Reduction Act would ultimately prove as a global subsidy for this investment. So I was wondering what that number looks like if you were to recalculate it, including taxpayer investment through the Inflation Reduction Act, and how that might compensate for the lower direct charges on carbon.
Catherine, okay, that one, I mean, it does help, right? It increases it from, let's say, $18. Well, it depends how much we spend on this, too. So it's not going to get you up to $100, but it might get you up to $40. I don't know, something like that. It's a step in the right direction. And so that's good. The other question was?
I think there was a net metering question up here, and people are not happy about net metering changes.
No, I agree. I have solar in my house, and I don't get paid for it as much anymore.
For those of us who don't have solar on our, we've been subsidizing you guys with solar.
There
on
you go.
We're still using electricity at night. The reliability, there was a question about reliability, kind of the very, as I interpreted it, the very local reliability. I think that's a really great question and a really big issue that we'll need to pay attention to. If we all get heat pumps and electric vehicles and there's a cold spell and the heat pumps are pumping out and we're trying to charge our cars, that's going to put a lot of strain on the local transformer. In a way,
we have a program at Stanford called EV50. What happens to the grid when you have 50% of the cars on the road that are EV, and when they start charging? And it's really the power demand is just massive if you're all charging at the same time. And frankly, this, if you add to that, the grid was never designed with a changing extreme weather conditions, we have potentially a real serious problem on our grid. So I think that question is very well taken, and I'm not sure the whole United States grid was never designed for A, solar and wind, number one, and B, with the idea that the climate is changing and there are weather extremes that's gonna happen. So I think we really need to, I'm hoping this infrastructure bill, as well the act and all, there's some resources out there to really look for the resilience and reliability of the grid. Okay, so any more questions? We have only half a minute. Way over there, two questions, quick ones.
You mentioned at a global level, it can be a challenging problem, coordinate across countries, and top-down policy may take years, if not decade, to implement. I wonder whether you hold any hope or your assessment is on using a distributed or decentralized technology such as blockchain to solve this problem.
And let's get one more, and then we're going to have quick answers.
Hi, I wondered whether the increase in the price of carbon to 130, whether that came about because of a change in the distribution of extreme events or what was driving the big jump up. And when you're really looking at the effects of technology, you have a technology part and then a behavioral part. And what bit of that do you feel you really don't know well? I know you have to throw estimates out and they're all important to convince people, but where do you think the uncertainty really lies?
So let's squeeze some quick answers. Okay. We're running out of time.
On the 130, it was really the science advancing and we got better at measuring the costs of climate change and the cost of extreme weather and those sorts of things. On the blockchain, I don't know. I haven't heard the compelling description of how blockchain helps us solve it, but that does not mean that it doesn't exist.
I think blockchain can be part of the solution in the sense of, I mean, some of these markets require more integrity, and maybe blockchain can help there. It's not a big part of the solution. And the $130 in Europe, is that what?
No, the social cost of carbon.
Oh, social cost of carbon, yeah, okay. Yeah.
With that, first of all, let's thank Mark for organizing this wonderful conference.